Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Pastor Dan Weiner, along with Pastor Brandi Hebert. We welcome you to this service this morning on the fifth Sunday of Easter. We extend a warm welcome to those who are visiting with us this morning. Especially, we have some members of the family, members of those first communicants this morning. We welcome you to the Lord's house here today. We also welcome this morning those who are joining us online for worship, and we welcome you to this service as well. Today, we will be starting a new liturgical setting, so we'll keep you on your toes a little bit. So we will live into it over the next several weeks. We have some choir members interspersed in the congregation this morning. So if you need to follow along, just get a little closer to a choir member, okay? The Kyrie is the first part of the new parts, and the entire congregation will sing that. It's a little different than the previous setting where the cantor would lead the congregation in the singing of the Kyrie. It is an honor and a privilege this morning to invite forward several of our youth will be receiving First Communion this morning. I've been duly instructed with a workshop the other week, and it's a wonderful celebration today in the Easter season to welcome them to the Lord's table this morning. And I'd like to invite them forward to receive a certificate at this time. Matthew Bowman and Lauren McNulty. You can stand right here and face the congregation. Yes? And they just look lovely here this morning. It makes me look better. We welcome you to the Lord's table this morning, and we are delighted that you will be joining us to receive our Lord's body and blood this morning. And I would encourage you, you know how many times Jesus says that we're supposed to come and receive it? Often. Do this as often as you drink and eat this, okay? Please give these young folks some encouragement. You can return to your places. Let us prepare our hearts for worship with the Caroline.
Stand as you are able for the confession of forgiveness. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Have mercy, O God. Against you, you alone, we have sinned. In your compassion, cleanse us from our sin and take away our guilt. Create in us a new heart and give us a steadfast spirit. Do not cast us away, but fill us with your Holy Spirit and restore your joy within us. Amen. As tender as parent to child, so deep is God's compassion for you. As high as heaven is above earth, so vast is God's love for you. As far as east is from the west, so far God removes your sin from you, renewing your life through Jesus Christ. Blessed be God who crowns us with mercy and grace. Blessed be God forever.
Oh,
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Give us grace to love one another, to follow in the way of his commandments, and to share his risen life with all the world. For he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Reading this morning is from the book of Acts, the 7th chapter. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against me. When he had said this, he died. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from the first letter of Peter, chapter 2. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, see, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. This honor, then, is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the excellence of him who called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself. So that is where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own. But the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This fifth Sunday of Easter, our lectionary turns our attention back to our Lord and Savior's teachings during his earthly ministry. One can imagine in the aftermath of the resurrection and Christ's multiple appearances, those first century disciples doing the same, turning their minds back towards their rabbi's teachings, trying to recall everything he had said and done, reflecting on what it might mean for them in their next steps as his disciples. The ministry of Jesus of Nazareth was brief, yet he and his disciples packed a lot into those estimated 3 years. Similarly, our scriptural texts are dense, richly layered with his teaching, demanding prayerful reflection and study discerning our next steps. This morning, in the midst of our world's ongoing turmoil, Jesus reminds us to not let our hearts be troubled. His words spoken just prior to his arrest and crucifixion are from the farewell discourse in John's Gospel, less a long goodbye and more like a series of last-minute teachings. Like a harried parent sending his now grown children out into the world for the first time, Jesus just lobs one more teaching after another at his disciples, punctuated with reminders. He knows where he's sending them and what they will encounter. He knows that he will not be able to accompany them in the same way that he has before. Do not be afraid, he reminds them. I am going before you to prepare a place for you.
There are many dwelling places in my Father's house. The spiritually young Thomas still cannot understand, asking, how can we know the way? And Jesus lovingly responds, he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. They know him. They've walked with him, yet Philip asks to be shown more. And Jesus instructs them simply to trust. Trust by doing the works as he has done, and those even greater for the glory of God. And whatever they ask in his name, he will do it. It's no wonder then that Jesus begins this teaching with, do not let your hearts be troubled. For the way, the truth, and the life that Jesus Christ embodied, that way that is leading him to the cross, is not for the faint of heart. Last weekend, I had the opportunity to visit my family in Texas to watch my sister perform at the Georgetown Palace Theater. I had never visited Georgetown, and last weekend, this bucolic, small Texas town hosted their annual poppy festival, celebrating the flower of the poppy. And as I wandered through the town square, replete with an old-fashioned soda shop and a courthouse, and country music wafted through the warm spring night, it was as if I had stumbled onto a picture-perfect movie set. I mean, I had half a heart, but I was going to run into Matthew McConaughey. Yet as I turned the corner of the town square, that picture-perfect moment came to a screeching halt. And instead of running into Mr. McConaughey, my heart stopped, for flying in front of their courthouse was a Confederate flag. I hear Jesus' words today. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And yet when confronted by this symbol being so proudly displayed, one that represents a failed insurrection that instigated the bloodiest war ever fought on this country's soil, a symbol that represents a people's insatiable desire to preserve an economic system that was made possible by human slavery, a symbol that serves nothing more to this day than to be a public performance of power and hate towards African Americans and all persons of color in this country, my heart is deeply troubled. How about yours? The rising trend of flying the Confederate flag in the U.S. is not limited to the South. Across the country, and I was shocked by this, 7 out of 10 white Christians, including mainline Protestants and Roman Catholics, strongly support flying the Confederate flag, even if it is offensive to African Americans. The most recognizable of the 3 Confederate flag designs, the stars and bars, intentionally bears a cross, positioned diagonally by its designer to avoid overt religious objection. This flag is uniquely intertwined with the rise of Christian nationalism in the U.S. over the last decade, and that is a cultural framework that was introduced even here in Pennsylvania during the last gubernatorial election. And it is one that dangerously distorts the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it is a horrifying affront to his crucified body. Like Thomas and Philip, we have been spiritually immature. Instead of longing for that spiritual milk so that we may grow in salvation, as 1 Peter suggests, we've taken matters into our own hands, overemphasizing the exclusivity of Jesus' words, like those found in our gospel today in John, weaponizing them to justify inflicting harm to still disastrous consequences for our day. Yes, we like to claim a personal salvation through Jesus Christ, but not a corporate one for all God's people. And yet Jesus begins his teaching today with an expression expansive, inclusive Christology, an expansive understanding of what his crucified body can mean. For there are many dwelling places in his Father's house. Divine love creates space for all God's children. Yes, Christ goes before us to prepare a place for us, but not only for us. For there are many dwelling places in the world in which divine love reigns. God's love is personal and universal. All are welcome. This is the way, the truth, the life that is Jesus. It is the way of self-sacrificing love. Self-sacrificing love in action for one's neighbor, as Jesus embodied throughout his life in miraculous healing and feeding, in acts of justice and solidarity, in the ordinary act of washing his disciples' feet and through the cross, in the laying down of one's life for God's people, and there creating new family in God's love. This is the only way. Yes, Jesus has shown us the way, that truth. This is the life. This is the life of discipleship, to do these works of Jesus, and in fact, even greater than these. There is so much work that awaits us as Christ's disciples in the days, weeks, months, and years ahead. For as my experience last weekend attests, we live in a world that increasingly demands a personal salvation at the expense of their neighbors. Lindsay Armstrong writes this: courageous conversations and intentional boundary crossing are not optional. Jesus removed barriers, drew alongside the stranger, and prepared many dwelling places within his Father's house. The moment is now to join this life-changing, life-giving work of making place. And we all remember the ministry theme for this year is hospitality, right? The moment is now to take seriously the witness of our lives. Let us act in the distinctive way God's household acts, living our story as Christ's story, as part of the family sent to show the deeply needed love of the one who welcomes, creates space, and family for all. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." I take solace in that. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Trusting in our Lord and Savior, we are commissioned and sent to do his good works, and even greater for our world in our time. Courageously removing barriers, welcome and creating space for all God's children, for the glory of God, for all God's people.
Thank you.
confess our Easter faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen.
United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of life, strengthen your church to proclaim your gospel even in times of trouble. Bless and strengthen all your people in their bridge-building ministry between church and world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, you show your steadfast love throughout your natural world. Protect the earth's diverse habitats from corrupting forces of pollution, erosion, extinction, and global warming. Hear us, O God. Mighty God, your Spirit guides us into all truth. Make your home among us. Abide with refugees, those experiencing homelessness, those fleeing war and poverty, and all who question if there is a home in your heart. Especially we pray for those in Sudan, Ukraine, and Russia. Today we also pray for all who are sick. Especially we lift up Donna Drummel, Nancy McGuire, Nick and Geraldine Anselmi, Sylvia Vinko, Christine Tupin, Ruth Wilkins, Phil Weber, Andrew Glassbrenner, Stan Stone, Michelle Young, Ryan Iaconelli, Keith Drozda, Barbara Burke, Emily Bowen, Brian Panapacker, David Seifert, Adriana DeLeo, Nancy Weaver, and those we name aloud or silently at this time. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Renewing God, you gather the saints at your heavenly banquet. We give you thanks for the care shown us by those who have gone before us, especially Paul Hahn and Peggy Kupitz. Grant confidence and comfort for all awaiting the place you have prepared. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace. This time we give thanks and joyfully give thanks for all this congregation supporting the ministries here at God's Love, living into that which is the way, the truth, and the life. The offering plates are available at the rear of the sanctuary to receive your gifts at the conclusion of worship today. Let us pray. Generous God, in this meal you offer your very self. We give thanks for these gifts of the earth. In the breaking of this bread, reveal to us the risen one. In the pouring of this wine, pour us out in service to the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Please rise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Teach us to pray together boldly. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Come and know Christ broken and poured out for you. You may be seated. The manner of receiving communion this morning will be continuous, but we will begin with first communicants and their families. They are all seated on this side, so that works very well. You will come out first, and then we will then resume with the rest of this side of the congregation. You will come out to the center aisle and return by the side aisle, and you can place your empty glass in the basket. Then we will move, after we've communed this side of the congregation, we'll move to the organ side. You will come out the center aisle, return by the side aisle. If you would prefer gluten-free or grape juice as you come forward, please indicate that.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in you we live and move and have our being. With your word and this meal of grace, you have nourished our life together. Strengthen us to show your love and serve the world, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
A couple of announcements about our life together in the church. Our new adult education series is a three-part program that begins today, immediately following worship, at 10 o'clock in the fellowship hall. We'll be focusing on feelings and faith. And this three-part series will conclude our spring adult education program. Today, we focus on anxiety. And so as we continue to live out of the pandemic and into a lot of the things that sometimes can trouble our hearts in this world, I hope to see everybody in the fellowship hall to talk about how our faith can guide us to be that non-anxious sent presence of the way, the truth, and the life. That's 10 o'clock at the fellowship hall. Also, tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock in the lounge, Pastor Dan will be leading the men's Bible study. There are a lot of exciting things happening in the church this month. Are there any other announcements for the good of the congregation?
I'll make one.
You've got one.
I'm grateful today for Carol and Larry Zetterberg and John Connors and Pastor Brandi. We all accompanied one another to the Synod Assembly over in Telford over the last 2 days. I'm proud to say that John was elected to the Synod Council and is also leading an effort with creation care on the synodical level. So I'm proud of our participation on a larger scale with the synodical ministry. So I'm grateful for those persons who carved out time and had to sit for long periods of time in beautiful days. So thank you.
And Pastor Dave, you just reminded me, we also wanted to thank Larry Whelan for organizing yesterday's collection on site with Good Stuff Thrift. It was a successful collection, and we were grateful for that partnership. So Larry, thank you. Let us stand for the blessing. God of all who raised Jesus from the dead, bless you by the power of the Holy Spirit to live into the new creation.
Thank you.
invite the congregation to join the first communicants and have a piece of cake in celebration of their first communion today. Go in peace, serve the risen one.
Thanks be to God.
One day I was just there.